to receive an honorary degree. It was a happening which compounded an already heavy sense of guilt I bore. As I told some of you at that time, I'd always figured the first degree you gave me was honorary. That first degree was 35 years and a few months ago. And as far as the students here are concerned now, that makes it definite that I'm not of your generation. It isn't true, however, that when Captain Burgess, for whom Burgess Hall is named, stood out under old recruiting elm, called up to what is now the windows of what is now the administration building, and urged the students to come down and join him and enlist in the Union Army, that I was among the first to go. Of course, there are those whose viewpoint politically differs from mine somewhat who suggest that I go farther back than that, to the Ice Age. Some would even suggest it's farther than that, to the time of McKinley. But there are some here today who can bear witness. Some I've already seen, such familiar faces of old friends who also share the memories of those dark depression days here in this campus. And they know that 35 years are like 35 minutes, so clean and fresh is memory. And no matter how much you students may want to believe this, your imaginations aren't up to it. You'll just have to wait and find out for yourselves, but you will find out that this is true. Now, if I seem to direct my remarks tonight mostly to the students, to that generation, bear with me, because I too am laboring here under a little misapprehension. Somehow, this didn't live up to my picture of it or my anticipation. I had pictured coming back as I have before, meeting with the students and a few old friends of my own time, and some of the good townspeople, and I would address myself to the students. But there's a tendency in today's world to put more than years between us. Somehow, as humans, we've been stratified into a horizontal society instead of a vertical one. All the layers of humanity today are separated into groups, age groups, from preschool to those the social tinkerers would refer to as senior citizens. And somehow, we're losing our ability to establish communication between these layers. And what's even worse, there's a growing hostility between the layers. Now, this is an unnatural situation. Humanity is vertically structured. The teenager will become the young married or the junior executive, and in turn the middle-aged and eventually the senior citizen. And each will take the faults and virtues, his pluses and minuses through the years, being at all times nothing more than the sum total of all that he's experienced. Separation into these horizontal groupings or layers just doesn't make any sense at all. For example, this widespread talk today, one end of the country to the other, that no one over 30 understands the youth of today. Well, now, if that's true, what happens when you reach 30? Do you suddenly join us and quit understanding those who haven't quite made the magic age? Each generation is critical of its predecessor. And as the day nears when the classroom and the playing field will give way to the larger arena with the problems of inequality and human misunderstanding, it's easy to look at those in that larger arena and demand to know why the problems remain unsolved. We who preceded you asked that question of those who preceded us, and another generation will ask it of you. And I sincerely hope there will be less justification for the question when it's your turn to answer. But what I'm trying to say is that no generation has failed completely, nor will yours succeed completely. But at the same time, don't get me wrong, when the generation of which I am a part leaves the stage of history, history will record that seldom has any generation fought harder or paid a higher price for freedom. We've known three wars in our lifetime and now a fourth. A cataclysmic depression that toppled governments and reshaped the map of the world. And because we couldn't find a single cure-all for man's inhumanity to man or the answer to human frailty, we ourselves have downgraded our performance, and we've confused you in so doing as well as ourselves. It's easy to point to our failures and to talk of the mess of our times and even to promise that we'll do better. But for the record, since we're the generation that exploded an atomic bomb and brought permanent terror to the world, we're also the generation that harnessed the atom for peaceful purposes. And some of those peaceful purposes are in medicine and industrial power. And we've brought man to the threshold of a fabulous era. We've defeated polio and tuberculosis and most of the plague diseases that held even more terror for mankind than the threat of the bomb. And it's a certainty that in this vertical structure, your generation and ours will overlap in defeating cancer. We point an accusing finger at the list of smog and water pollution and poverty and civil rights and inequality of opportunity, and we still seek the answers. And while many disagree as to the solutions, let's make it plain that we were the ones who faced up to those problems, and we charged ourselves with finding the answers, and no one in today's public life can fail to treat with them and remain in public life very long. This horizontal stratification has led to a lateral communication. And I think it's highly important that we restore vertical dialogue, if not outright recognition, of the naturalness and the rightness of the vertical structuring of society. How well do you young people understand those whose defect today is that they've reached age 30 plus? Can you possibly believe that your fathers who knew the savagery of World War II, or your grandfathers who came of age in the muddy trenches of the Great War, could have an affection for war? That we could callously send our sons to war? Permit me here to try and build at least a footbridge between the age groups of parent and offspring. And remembering all the time that bridges are open to traffic both ways. You young people, that fellow with the thickening waistline and the thinning hair sometimes is a little unreasonable about your allowance or letting you have the family car. His life seems a little dull to you as he reports for his daily 9-to-5 chores or looks forward with great excitement to lowering his golf handicap or catching a fish that no one in the family wants to eat. But I wish you could have known him a few years back. I wish you could have known him when he was on a landing barge off the shores of Normandy, or Tarawa, or even just on a weekend pass in Peoria. He was quite a guy. Winston Churchill said of him, he was the only man in the world who could laugh and fight at the same time. And General Marshall called him our secret weapon. And if you'll forgive the bluntness of the language, remembering the time in which it was spoken and that he was a military man, General Marshall said of this young fellow from America, he and his friends, they were just the best damn kids in the world. He hated war more than he hated the enemy, but he did what had to be done. And a few years after the end of World War II, I have to pause for a little personal anecdote. I was in a pub, a little rural pub in England, and there was a motherly soul waiting on the trade there, and she finally figured out that I was an American. I can't tell how she did that for the life of me. And then she started telling me a little story. She was reminiscing. She sat there and her eyes looked kind of far away and she said, oh, you know, she says, during the war, there were a great many of your chaps stationed just across the road here. And she said, they used to come in to see us all the time and they'd have song fests every night. And she says, they called me Mom and called the old man Pop. And she said, Christmas Eve, we were sitting here and we were all alone. And she said, the door burst open and in they came. And she says, they had presents for me and Pop. And then they sang some more. And oh, she says, it was a wonderful Christmas. And she said, there was great big strapping lads from a place called Iowa. Well now, these fellas, they knew what it was to dream, this fella I'm talking about, to say goodbye to a girl and wonder if ever he'd see her again. They cussed the world that let things like that war happen, and they swore to do better when they got back and were running the show themselves.